So, MRI stands for magnetic resonance imaging. So, M is actually it's a magnetic field that we using to use the, to align the protons of our body. The R stands for resonance. It's a phenomena due to the application of radio frequency pulse. The I is imaging with the help of the relaxation process. So, first we learn about the magnets, then what is the resonance, then imaging process. This is going to be learned in the following slides. Magnets, the type of magnets, this is majorly divided into two things. One is permanent magnet, another one is electromagnet. Electromagnet further divided into resistive magnet and superconducting magnet. Nowadays, the resistive magnets are absolute, not very used, but the superconducting magnets are the majorly used in the higher-end machines. Permanent magnet is a large horseshoe magnet, which direction is anterior to posterior, that is from up to down, and it is always on irrespective of the power supply. This major advantage of the permanent magnet is a low running cost and the maximum field is 0.3 Tesla. But this is the only disadvantage. Higher end things are that applications we can use in higher end machines so cannot be done with the permanent magnets. Superconduction magnets or electromagnets, the magnetic field results due to the flow of electrons through the wires. The electrons are flowing through the coil type of wire that magnetic field is created around the coils. So, superconduction magnets or the electromagnet, the superconductivity will come only the supercooling, that's cryogens are used, like a liquid helium or liquid nitrogen. These are the cryogens used to keep the temperature very low of the coils, which makes no resistance for the power supply, which makes the superconductivity. So, in superconducting magnets, this alloy used is niobium titanium, which are supercooled, and then it is get the no resistance status, then it become a superconducting magnet. So the liquid, the during the superconductivity, the lot of heat is produced to prevent the boil off. Liquid nitrogen and liquid helium are used. The maximum field strength for the superconducting magnets are nowadays 3 Tesla is commonly available everywhere, and in some centers recently the 7 Tesla machines are coming into clinical practice. So far we learn about magnets and the types of the magnets. Now we're going to learn about the magnetic field. What is a field? It's a nothing but the region around the magnets where the objects are experience the force of the magnet. This is simply called as a magnetic field. So magnetic field is induced if and only if there is a moving electrical charge. If the electrical charge, if it's moved, then only its electric field is created. The unit of the magnetic field is Tesla, and 1 Tesla is a 10,000 cos. The Earth magnetic field strength is 0.05 milli-Tesla. Now, we'll learn about the nuclear spin. For imaging purpose, the hydrogen nucleus is used because it is abundant in our body. The hydrogen proton can be linked to the planet of Earth, which is spinning on its axis with the north to south pole. So, in this respect, it behaves like a small bar magnet. So, each and every hydrogen atom in our body, which has a positive charge in the nucleus, which is spinning. So, once it's spinning, its magnetic field is created. So, each and every hydrogen atom, proton, the nucleus is in our body, is act like a small bar magnet. So, and with and the hydrogen proton, the hydrogen proton, when it is placed in a normal circumstance, it is randomly accessed. It is spinning in a different directions. But when the body is placed in a strong magnetic field, what will happen? They are aligned in a north pole, either north pole or south pole, two directions only. Majority of the things are aligned in the strong magnet, the parallel to the magnetic directions, field direction. The protons which are placed in the strong magnetic field, not stable, which are spinning in their own axis, and it's spinning like a wobbling top, which is called precessor, which means the tail of the vector is stationary, it's fixed, it's spinning its own axis here, and the head is revolving like a spinning top, which is called precession. Now, we learn about precession and the precession frequency. The precessional frequency is not same for the R magnetic field strength. Suppose if it is a 0.5 Tesla, it is the frequency is 21.3 MHz. But it is not same for the 1.5 Tesla. So 1.5 Tesla, it is 63.9 MHz. It's purely derived from the in a formula, it's a Larmor equation. It is purely based on the multiplication of the, that's a frequency in revolution per second, and it's a magnetic field strength, and that's a gyromagnetic ratio. So the each and every magnetic field strength machines having the different positional frequencies. Based on the frequency, you have to apply the radio frequency for to flip the long-term magnet to the transverse magnetization. Now, we learn about radio waves. So magnet we learn, precession learn, everything is that. And now, radio waves. What is the role of the radio waves? So merely keeping the object or the body inside the bore, inside the magnet, will not bring the image, will not give the image. We have to flip the M vector into the transverse side. For that, we have to give some energy to the proton with the help of the radio waves. The radio waves are applied in a particular frequency which is equal to the Larmor frequency of the hydrogen proton of the particular field strength. Then only it gets the energy, then it is flipped. Then if you off the radio waves, then it will bring to the proton that the original position from that time. It releases the signals. These signals are received from the antennas and these are formed images. For radios are the very vital roles in forming of the image. This picture explains you what is a resonance. It is a race. There are two cars, one in different speeds actually. And this fellow having the burger, but this fellow is very hungry. But this fellow doesn't have any food. So this fellow asked him to give the food. Now what will happen? They are in a different speed, so it is very difficult to transfer the food from one car to another car. So what we'll do to give a food from one car to another car? Let's see. Now the cars with the different speeds are now in a same speed. Once it comes to the same speed, they are come very close to. So now it is a possibility of passing the food from here to here, one car to another car. Similarly, if two things are vibrating in a same frequency, it is possible to transfer the energy from one to another one. Similarly, in MRI, when applying the radio frequency equivalent to the Larmor frequency of the hydrogen photon, this energy is transferred to the hydrogen photon and it gets flipped. So this is a thing we call as a resonance. Now, we're going to learn about what is the relaxation process of image formation. Assume there is a magnet, north and south pole, in which that you put the patient. Once you put the patient, all the photons are aligned in the direction of the north to south pole. So this, once it is in the inside the Bohr magnet, before applying the R of pulse, this M is at the longitudinal magnetization maximum, and the transverse magnetic MY is zero before applying the R of pulse. Once you apply the R of pulse equivalent to the Larmor frequency of the hydrogen photon, what will happen? These photons get energy and flip into the transverse plane. So that means the transverse, once it is flipped into the transverse plane, this MZ is zero. That's the longitudinal magnetization zero, and the transverse magnetization is the maximum. So suddenly you stop the radio frequency giving the energy, you stop the energy giving to the hydrogen photon. What will happen? It will return to the normal position, to the original position. By returning to the normal routine position, the original position, this MZ is growing slowly. At the same time, this MY also, it's come down, it is reducing slowly. So after some time, it will, what will happen, it grows slightly. Finally, this MZ come to the original position and MY becomes a zero. So this growing of the MZ is called the T1 recovery, and this reducing of the transverse magnetism we call as T2 decay. So what is T1 relaxation? It's simply, we can say it's a regrowth of the MZ minimum to maximum. It's a time taken for the 63% of longitudinal magnetization to recover. Similarly, T1 relaxation, it is a decay of MZ, the transverse magnetization, from the maximum to minimum. It's a decay of the maximum to minimum. It's a MY. So if you measure the MZ, it is a T1 relaxation, then it is MY, it is a T2 relaxation. So each tissue in our body having the T1, T2 values, that will not be the same for all the tissues. Example, if you take the CSF, which the T1 value is 2400, similarly, and then T2 value is 160. So always the T1 is maximum, it is higher numbers, T2 is a minimum number. So you have to keep in mind that the T1 value is always greater than the T2 value. The tissues having the T1, T2 values, in which T1 is always greater than the T2. Now we are going to learn about the MRI pulse counter. There are number of sequences available in MRI machines. This selection of sequences and an application to the particular clinical history and diagnosis. It is almost operator dependent, and each and every institution has their own protocols. And now you see what are the basic pulse sequences in this presentation. The pulse sequences are the very basics for the MRI imaging. The pulse sequence of a computer software program that controls MRI curves, which has so many parameters like a TR, TE, and TI, in which this R of radio frequency and gradient pulse are repeated many times during the scan time. This is a typical diagram of the pulse sequences. Initially, we apply the 90-degree R of pulse and then wait for some time, and we collect the signals. This is a single cycle. It will be repeated again and again in the following single sequences. So it will be the time in between the two 90-degree R of pulse is called the time of repetition. The time between the 90-degree R of pulse and the echo is called the time of echo. There are three types of images are available. One is T1, T2 and PD images that we see one by one. This is a T1 weighted image which has TR and TU value. It is short, both are short. Chartia and Chartii. It is the best for anatomic details. You see that this is the T1 weighted image. Always it is Chartia and Chartii. This is a T1 weighted image which has a parameter of TR, long TR, that is around 3000, and that long T, both are long. In T1 it both are short, in T2 it both are long. It is around 100 is T. It is a milli, it is measured in the milliseconds. That whatever you see in the black in the T1, it will see in the bright almost. Then the CSFR in black in the T1, it is very bright in T2. It is very much useful to see the pathology. There is another type of image, which is called photon density imaging, which has a long TR around 3000. T is very low. Here, the long TR, short TE. It is applied for the PD images. Normally, this PD is nowadays not using in the brains. It's a PD image of the brain. Instead of that, FLAIR is used. And this PD is nowadays mostly used frequently in musculoskeletal radar, MR imaging. So this is a comparison between the T1, T2 and PD. The parameters which has the T1 having the shorter TR and shorter TE, and the T2 is long TR, long T. This is a short, long, and PD having the long TR and short TE. So keep in mind that is a T1 and T2 refers to the tissue properties, but the TR and TE refers to the equipment parameters, which is used in the pulse sequences. There are two basic pulse sequences are available. One is a spin echo and second gradient echo sequence. All other sequences are variation of this with the different parameters added on. Let me see one by one. Already we have seen what is TR and TE. Now there's another parameters called the TI, time of inversion. It is a time between the initial 180 degree RF pulse inverting the RF pulse and the next 90 degree RF pulse in inversion recovery sequences. It is T is always used in the inversion recovery sequences. Another one is a flip angle. It is always used in the gradient sequences, which is shorter RF pulse, usually less than the 90 degree is in the gradient sequence, is called the flip. This diagram shows a spin echo sequence. It is a very basic and a simple sequence. Initially, it's a 90 degree RF pulse is applied, followed by and the 180 degree RF pulse is refocusing pulse is applied. Then the images are that echoes are collected. This is a simple. So say here, just keep in mind that's a 90 degree RF pulse followed by 180 degree RF pulse, then collection of echo. This is a simple sequence for the The spin echo sequence have a higher having higher SNR and higher spatial resolution and very least artifact prone sequence. So clear contrast mechanism is seen with the spin echo sequences, but it has a disadvantage of the higher SIR than the GRE sequence, because it is there's a 90 degree RF pulse and followed by 180 degree RF pulse. Two RF pulse are applied, but in the GRE sequence less than 90 degree RF pulse is applied. And it is incompatible with the 3D sequence, the acquisition due to the longer TR, and its acquisition time also very. Some of the variant sequence are available that be in the spin echo sequence, in which the fast spin echo sequence and the inversion recovery sequence. It is a stir flare come under the category of inversion recovery. This is the diagram of the fast spin echo, and this is spin echo. So what is the difference is that in spin echo only one 180 degree RF pulse is applied in a single cycle, but it is in the fast spin echo, it's a multiple 180 degree RF pulses applied after the 90 degree RF pulse, which reduces scan time, and the additional parameters the echo train length is added in the fast spin echo sequence. Another type of variant is inversion recovery sequence. And it is very similar to the spin echo sequence, but initially it starts with the 180 degree RF pulse, the flip the longitudinal magnetism the opposite directions it is very much useful to eliminate the signals from the fat or water. Here the another parameter is the time of inversion. This is the time taken from the initial 180 degree RF pulse to the next 90 degree RFLs is called the time of inversion. It will vary for the fat and plastic ones, for the fluid suppression. Still is a sequence used to suppress the signal from the fat, because the fat has seen that T1 time is very short, and if you keep the time of inversion less than it is less than 180, that is around 150, then the fat signals will be eliminated, which is very much useful for the musculoskeletal imaging. But the scan time is very long. That is disadvantage for this still sequence, and the resolution also very little poor compared to the other sequences. This is a clear example for the still sequence. It is very bright signals in the seen in the T1 weighted image and the coronal and the axials. Then the still sequence, this is a still sequence, completely the signals from the bright area is suppressed. So it is confirmed as a fat. It is a fatty mass. So to a musculoskeletal imaging, the still sequence are very much useful. Another inversion recovery sequence is FLAR. It's a fluid attenuation inversion recovery, which is suppress the signals from the water. The T1 time is very long for the water, with a TI is at 2000 milliseconds. It eliminates the signals from the CSF. It very much useful to identify the edemas and very good useful to the neuroradiology, but it has a very little long scan time. FLAR is available in a T2 weighted image and T1 weighted image also, but the T2 weighted image is very much useful to identify the edemas and periventricular lucencies. This is a good example for the FLAR image. So the actual T2 images, it is very difficult to see the pathology, that's edema over here. But that FLAR sequence, the same plane and sections, so the edema is very much highlighted with the help of the FLAR sequence. This is the advantage of the FLAR sequence, and as well as the periventricular lucencies, the hypertonic signals are very much nicely seen with the FLAR sequence. But in the T2, it is bright, also the CSF also bright, these periodic lesions also bright, so it is very difficult to differentiate that. Now you see what is the gradient sequence. This is a spin echo sequence, and typically the gradient sequence which doesn't have that two major things. One is there is no 180 degree R pulse to refocus, as well as there's a 90 degree R pulse is not used in the gradient echo sequence. Less than 90 degree, which is called the flip angle, is used in the gradient echo sequences. These are the parameters for the gradient echo sequence. Apart from the TR and TE, this additional parameter is called the flip angle is included in the gradient echo sequences. And this gradient echo sequence are very much useful to identify the calcifications as well as the hemorrhages in the neuroradiology. GRE sequence are further classified into two things. One is spoiled residual TM sequences. Another one is refocused TM transverse magnetization sequences. And the SPGR come in this category, and it's the Fiesta, CIS, all the things are come in this category. The steady state free position sequence are post gradient sequences. If he has to come in this category, we are seeing the very thin section we can be done at the 0.8 mm sections, and the high resolution imaging is far possible. We can reformat it in this airplane. It's actually on this coronal, sagittal, and oblique, all the curve reformation, anything we can be done. It is very much useful for the IAM and other cranial nerve image. This is an example for the use of the past gradient sequence like in Fiesta and the SPGR. This is the Fiesta C showing the cranial nerves, and which is thickening of the cranial nerve. This much of the resolution is not possible with the conventional sequences. And this is a sequence with called as a SPGR with post contrast, which is showing nice enhancement of the third cranial nerve. And we can do the reformation, all the things with the help of the tools, the multi-format tools. Magnetic resonance angiography is an imaging technique to visualize the blood vessels. Multiple RF pulses with a short TR used to suppress the signals from the stationary tissues, and the moving blood is unaffected with the repetitive RF pulse. The blood signals are not suppressed and appear as hyper intense, very bright. So the background disc is suppressed, the signals from the blood is highlighted. This is very much to see the aneurysm and vascular anomaly. Deficient weighted image, it's based on the echoplanar imaging. Diffusion of water molecules reduce MR signals. Lower diffusion areas are so the brighter in images, where it is very sensitive to detect the acute infarct. It is usually the sequences added into the stroke protocol. And it can be done at within 30 seconds, and we can identify the acute infarct. This is an example for the diffusion weighted image, which showing the acute infarct and this area, this bright signals are the acute infarct area. And it is this sequence is usually included in the stroke protocol. And this is the ADC mapping. It can be done with the help in the based on the diffusion weighted image to confirm whether it is acute or chronic. When plain study is inconclusive, the contrast enhanced MRI is followed. So gadolinium based contrast is administered IVly, then followed by T1 fat suppression sequence or the in all three plane, axial, coronal and sagittal planes. There are some reasons, good reasons for the use of the contrast agents in MRI scans. Oh, this pathology that is sometimes not seen on the unenhanced images becomes obvious in the presence of the contrast. Enhancement significantly increases the MRI sensitivity and also accurately characterizes the different type of lesion. This is the advantage of for the contrast enhanced MRI. This is an example for the contrast enhanced MRI. It's a plain study which shows some edemas and some mouse lesions, but clear cutly it's where the extension of the lesions and the size of the lesions cannot be it's estimated with the help of the plain. So IV contrast with the fat suppression is done, and that clearly that's the lesion, the mass lesion is enhanced with the administration of contrast. This is advantage for the contrast administration in MRI.